one of those black boxes or hand it to one of our greeters on your way out here this morning. But we're so glad that you're here with us. Church family, on the back of that too is prayer requests. We are a staff that believes in praying for you as much as possible. And so if you have any prayer requests for us as a pastoral staff where we can be praying for you, please feel free to fill that out and drop it off in the back as well. Well, I'm so thankful for Father's Day, and I'm thankful for a God who is a good, good, good Father. And I'm excited that we get to continue on and worshiping him this morning. So let me pray for us as we continue on to worship. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just praise you for who you are. Father, I'm thankful that we can gather here this morning and be reminded of truth and how good of a God you are, and how you are a loving Father who loves us so much that you are willing to send your one and only Son to die for us. Lord, I'm so grateful and appreciative of that, and I pray that we're reminded of that truth here this morning. Father, I pray that we tune our ears into you and we listen to you this morning as your word is proclaimed and as we sing songs and praises to you, Lord, that we would prepare our hearts to receive your word. Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the gospel, and we thank you for the work that you're doing through us. In your name we pray. Amen.
All right, church, if you could, let's stand once again and join our voice as we sing about the testimony that we are dead in our trespasses and God brought us to life. Let's sing it together.
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Yes, I do. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. Yes, my praise is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Come together, sons and daughters.
Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what he started. Yes, our God will finish what he started. This is my testimony. My story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Whoa. I love those next two lines right here. Let's sing it together.
If I'm not dead and you're not done, cause greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead and you're not done, and you're not done, Lord, the greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead and you're not done, greater things are still to come. Testimony from death to life, cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. Oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony. Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Whoa.
I did earlier. I'm going to do it again. We read that line, if I'm not dead, then you're not done, for greater things are still to come. false teachers here in our reality, in our day, Bruce, you can go ahead, but in our reality, they teach that the greater things that we need to be expecting on this life, that we are living our best life now. I truly believe that our best life is yet to come, because what Jesus has promised us and what God has promised us in heaven. Like, there's nothing compared to what we're going to see in days to come, when he takes us home and where we go to see him. But I pray that while we are here, we worship him. While we are here, we share our testimony to what he has done in our lives. I pray that while we are here, we encourage somebody, just like his word says, encourage one another and build each other up. I pray that we do all those godly things, yes, but with anticipation. May our worship be to what's yet to come. You know, to thank him for what he's done on the cross for us, but get excited to what's to come. And it is eternal life through Jesus Christ in heaven with God the Father. So the next song that we're going to sing, the choir has been working on it, but they ain't here tonight, this morning. We're going to be taking a break for the next few weeks in preparation for our fall and Christmas season. But it's a song that just reminds us that our God's the same God from yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He's the God of Joseph. He's the God of Mary that rescues the lowly. He's the God of David that uses a shepherd boy. He's our same God today. So we're going to sing this song together here this morning. And in our prayer is that you believe and trust in the God that is for us at every step that we take.
You are the same God.
our provider. Amen. Amen. Glory be to God. You may be seated, church.
I would encourage you, if you ever not have the opportunity to sit closer to the front on Sunday morning, you should give it a shot. I say that in all seriousness because it's sometimes it's hard for me to worship because I'm so encouraged by the faithfulness of God's people singing corporately together. And it's just so beautiful. And so thank you for worshiping together as a faith family today. Let us go to the Lord in prayer as Pastor comes to preach. Heavenly Father, Lord of all, Creator of all things that are good and the one who blesses, we come before you today and we stretch out our unclean hands. We open up and give you our impure hearts. And we ask that you would have compassion on us, that you would grant us mercy, that you would give us through the preaching of your word and the word itself, truth, that we would receive virtue and faith and knowledge. And we pray that the Spirit would be with us now as we submit humbly to you in our own weaknesses, that you would lift up your people now and make us gentle and sober-minded. Cleanse us and set us apart to worship you and live for you rightly. God, we ask that your Spirit would work in our minds and in our hearts to give us grace to learn the scriptures in order to understand and interpret its meaning, so that others in our lives would be encouraged and blessed by us receiving your word here today now. And that through your word, by the power of the Spirit, we would live for Christ, our Lord, our Redeemer, our Savior, our King, through whom and to you, Lord Jesus, belong the glory and the strength, both now and forevermore. It's in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen.
This week, I had the opportunity to attend the Southern Baptist Convention, and I want to thank the church for allowing me to go and allowing me to serve in the roles that I'm asked to serve in. It's always good to go to the convention to see co-laborers and friends in the Lord, those who share in partnership with us in the gospel. In many ways, going to the Southern Baptist Convention is a lot like going to a family reunion. You see people that you just want to sit and talk with for hours. And then you get stuck with people that you have to talk with for hours. The Southern Baptist Convention is an odd group, for sure. Our annual meeting is one of the few places that you'll go to where you will see people worshiping with all their heart, laying out their praise before God, and then like 2 minutes later, arguing over Robert's Rules of Order. It is an unusual thing. It's like a family. We have sweet grandparents and wonderful brothers and sisters, and a lot of crazy uncles. And I saw many of them this week. We're not perfect. In fact, in my opinion, there's some things that we got wrong this week at our convention. But there are a lot of things that we got right as well. We stood firm on our commitment that the Bible is the authoritative word of God. We renewed our commitment to keep our churches from places where sexual abusers can continue to harm individuals. We took a strong stand against harmful transgender ideology that's being pushed on our children and in our culture. We proclaim that artificial intelligence needs to be developed in alignment with moral values as described in the scripture. But by far, my favorite thing that we did at the Southern Baptist Convention this year was we commissioned 46 households, 79 individuals from 46 churches spread across 19 different states to go out into the world and share the name of Jesus. And if you've never seen a commissioning service, I hope that you get the opportunity to do that in your lifetime. It's incredibly moving and convicting to watch people who are sacrificing so much. Some of these families were saying goodbye to their elderly parents, knowing it was probably their final goodbye. Some of them were leaving adult children who were about to birth their grandchildren and know that they're going to miss some of the formative years of their children being raised. Some of them were going into incredibly difficult areas that are hostile to Christianity, knowing that their decision to go could cost them their life. Why would they do this? I mean, why would they willingly do this? Because people need to hear. You see, this group is aware that the greatest problem in our world is lostness. And they see people who are separated from God by their sin, and they believe that Jesus is the answer. And they are men and women who see those in foreign lands and don't see faceless enemies, but they see potential brothers and sisters. And they're driven by the vision that God gave to the Apostle John when he was on the island of Patmos. And they dream of a day that this vast multitude around the throne from every nation and tribe and people and language will proclaim the praises of the Lamb of God that was slain for our sins. They're motivated to go. That's why they go to hard places. That's why they go to often hardened people, because they believe that God will save some. And Paul, the author of Romans, was driven by this dream. He says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew and also to the Greek. And Paul lays out in the book of Romans with laser-focused logic what this gospel is. The first thing he tells us is that God has clearly revealed himself. In chapter 1, he talks about God revealing himself in a couple of ways, but God has revealed himself in several ways. One, God has revealed himself through our desire for meaning. We desire to know what life's all about and what makes life significant and what is our purpose on earth. That is evidence that there is a God who has put that in our hearts. God has revealed himself in our hope for immortality. We believe that there's more than just this life, and that death is not the end. And we have this longing in the human heart to think that there is something next. God has revealed himself through our sense of moral accountability, that we know right and wrong. Every culture has some sense of what right is and what wrong is. God has placed that in our heart. We also see God through creation. A person may have never heard the name of God, but the human heart instinctively knows that he is there. And yet, Paul says, we reject him. All have. Our hearts are so corrupt that rather than submit to the knowledge that's been given to us and seek him with all of our heart, we rebel against him. We reshape God into an image that fits us and we can manipulate, and we refuse sometimes to even acknowledge that he exists. And Paul says in Romans 2 and 3, this is why God is going to pour out his wrath on humanity. If our hearts are so wicked that we suppress the knowledge of an all-powerful ruling God, then surely we deserve his wrath. You know, if a person puts their fist in the face of God and says, I don't want to submit to your rule, and I'm going to do what I want to do, God is understandably angry. And Paul says we will face the wrath of God unless we receive the salvation that God has made possible. Into this darkness and death of sin, a filled world, Jesus has come, and he has redeemed us from the curse of the law. He lived the life that we were supposed to live, and by the cross, he died the death that we were supposed to die, and it was purely an act of grace. He provided this salvation to all who would trust him. when you will move your faith from yourself and you place that faith on Christ, you are delivered from your sin, you're delivered from the wrath of God, and you do have a hope of eternal life with God in heaven. This was good, and this was news. It was news because it was revolutionary, that being right with God was something that came by grace and not law, by Jesus's free gift, and our placing faith in what he had done. We were made right with God, and this was good news, but it was also news because of who the gift was offered to. You see, God offered this gift to anyone who would come. Paul said it wasn't just for the Jews. The gospel was also for the Greeks. And then we pick back up in Romans chapter 10 today. He says in verse 11, everyone who believes on him will not be put to shame. You see, where Paul's going to land this in Romans 10 and 11 is that all people have the responsibility, all of us have the mandate to put our trust in Christ, to move it from ourselves onto him. You see, every person's going to stand before God at judgment, but the one who trusts Christ will never be put to shame. And he says in verse 12 that there is no distinction between the Jew and the Greek. There should be no social hierarchy in the church. God does not have alternate methods of salvation for groups because of their ethnic backgrounds. We're all recipients of the same grace. We all have the same standing before God. We're all promised the same hope. We all enter into the kingdom the same way. And by the way, the inclusion of Greeks and Gentiles into the kingdom is not a new thing. Here in verse 13, he says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is a quote from the Old Testament. This is a quote from the prophet Joel. All the way back in the Old Testament, we see that God wanted the nations to be glad. It's not a plan B where, well, the Jews didn't receive it, I better let the Gentiles in. This was plan A all along. This was God's design from the beginning. Even when he called Abraham, he said, I will bless you so that you can be a blessing to the nations. This was God's intent. Notice the word in verse 13, Lord. In Joel, when you read this in the Hebrew, it is the word Yahweh, that proper name for God that was revealed to Moses at the burning bush, at the one that is and doesn't need anything else to be, the great I am. That was the name for God. And when you read the Old Testament, you see capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. That is a reference to Yahweh and his proper name. How intriguing is it that when Paul's thinking about Jesus and people needing to call on him, he quotes from this Old Testament verse that everybody knew was referring to God. He says, whoever calls on God, and he's revealed his name as Jesus, shall be saved. Paul is saying Jesus is the creator. Jesus is the sustainer. Jesus is the sovereign over his universe. I love the phrase, everyone who calls. You see, there's room in the word everyone for you and me. This passage is an invitation to receive the Lord Jesus Christ in the grace that he offers. Now, if everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, it's important for everybody to hear the message of the gospel. Beginning in verse 14, Paul shifts to talking about the role we play in helping others believe. And he asks a series of four questions. He says, how then can they call on him they have not believed in? If people don't call on the name of the Lord, it's because they don't believe that he is the answer. If I have a medical issue, I don't call my CPA. No matter how good of a CPA he or she may be, I don't call on them because I don't believe they really understand what's going on in my physical body. So I don't call them if I have a need. A lot of people don't believe that Jesus is someone who understands what they need. I get that. Some people reject the gospel. Some people reject claims of the resurrection. Some people don't believe that Jesus has anything to offer them and he's not significant to their life. They're atheists and agnostics and secularists. I don't understand because I see the beauty and the value of Jesus, but they don't call on Jesus because they don't believe in his value. But here's what I want you to hear this morning. Many people don't call on the name of Jesus because they don't believe in him, because they've never heard of him. That's why they don't call. And how can they believe without hearing about him? Does anybody know what November 15th, 2022, why it's significant? Does anybody know the significance of November 15th, 2022? That's 8 billion day. That's the day that the earth population flipped from being in the 7 billions to being in the 8 billions. At most, there are 2.6 billion Christians in the world, and that number includes avid churchgoers, but it also includes Mormons. It also includes Jehovah's Witnesses. It also includes Christian Scientists. It also includes anybody who shows up for a Notre Dame football game. It includes all of those people. And I know, and you know, there aren't that many believers, right? I mean, we know that. But even if there were 2.6 billion Christians, that means there's almost 5.5 billion people on this planet who are not believers. The Joshua Project, a missions research company, estimates that almost 3 billion of those are completely unchurched, which they define as it stands today, right now, they have no real chance in their lifetime to hear the gospel before they die. If you lined up 3 billion people, 25 across, you could wrap the globe with the number of people who are marching toward their destruction, who have never heard the gospel of Christ. I don't know if you realize how fortunate you are. You get to sit under gospel privilege day in and day out. You hear the gospel preached at church. You hear the gospel taught in Sunday school. You can turn on the TV and hear the gospel of Christ. You can tune into the radio and hear the gospel of Christ. You can get a podcast at any point, in any place, on your phone, and hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Here's what I want you to do right now. 25 wide, standing in a single file lines, 25 of them, circling the globe. I want you to picture in your mind that those people are people just like you. People who are made in the image of God, just like you. People who feel fear, just like you. People who get lonely, just like you. People who don't know forgiveness. People who've never heard of a Savior. Carl F. Henry said, the gospel means good news, but it's only good news if it gets to somebody in time. Often people wonder, well, what if somebody had never heard the gospel of Jesus, but they responded to what they saw in creation, or they followed their conscience, and they said, God, whatever you are, or wherever you are, you know, I don't know everything, or maybe really anything about you, but I want to know you, and I surrender to you. Wouldn't that be enough? Well, it's an interesting question, but here's the reality. It never happens. It never happens. It doesn't happen because of what Paul said in Romans chapter 3. There's nobody who's righteous, not one person. And he goes on to say in verse 11, there's nobody who understands and there's nobody who seeks God. It just doesn't work that way. God has sought us. And we have to tell people about that news. And how can they believe without hearing? He repeats this in verse 17, which is going to be the last verse we look at today. There's a couple more, but we'll come back to it. But in verse 17, he says, faith comes from what is heard. The way that faith comes alive in a person's heart is they hear the message. And the message that they hear is the message of Christ. What stimulates faith in the human heart is the message that God came down to us. It's the message that he bore our sin. It's the message that he rose from the dead. And something about that message is like dynamite to the soul. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It is power. That story is power. Now, I want you to realize today that the message of Christ is our message. If you get weary of hearing that each week, you probably need to find another church, because that is our message. This is who we are. This is what we have. It is what transforms lives. It's what gives hope to suffering people. It is what enables us to stand against whatever comes our way in culture. This is our message. We have no other. We're not a political voting bloc, even though I hope you vote. We are not a social needs community, even though we should respond to hurting people. We are not the last defense against an immoral culture, even though we should be holy. We are gospel proclaimers. That is who we have been called to be. And I know there's real heartbreaking problems in the world. The war in Ukraine and Russia is heartbreaking. The ethnic cleansing in Sudan is atrocious. The poverty in much of India, oh my goodness, the oppressive regimes in the Middle East and Southeast Asia, the unsanitary conditions in Central America and in much of Africa, and human trafficking all over the globe. We should care about these things. We should care about the marginalized. We should care about suffering in the world. But I want you to understand this. The worst kind of suffering that a person can possibly face is eternal suffering. And that is why we proclaim that the greatest problem in the world is lostness. That is the greatest problem known to man. And how can the 5 billion hear the message of Christ unless there's a preacher? And it's not talking about me getting up here in front of people who show up on Sunday. It's talking about those of us who go out and tell the story every day, those of us who proclaim the message of Christ. How will people hear a witness if they do not have people to take the gospel message to them? That's why missions should be an active part of the strategy of the church. We must not only have preachers who go to local places in need of pastors, and we must, but we must also call out people to go to the uttermost parts of the earth, because if there is only one way of salvation, and we are the only ones trusted with the message, we must take the gospel to those who have not heard. And then he says, and how can we take that message unless they are sent? There is a relocation aspect to gospel saturation. We must go into all the world to make disciples. That's why I'm thankful for Jenna Reed and Emma Russell and Melissa Richards and Drew McConnell and Kat Rankin and Zeke Atha and Chloe Stivers and many other college students who've given their summer to take the gospel around Kentucky and around the world. I'm thankful for Dylan and Asara Lancaster and Abby Eplin and Jenna Reed, who are currently pursuing what a long-tenured mission might look like. I'm thankful for the David and Carol Parkses and the Chandler and Kelly Snyders and the Megan Lewises and the Omar and Tia DeLoses and the Dell Raglands and the many, many others who've gone out from this church, have relocated their families, and have taken the gospel to the nations. And yet I pray for more. And the reason I pray for more is because of what our Lord said: the harvest is abundant, but the workers are few. And therefore, we pray that God would send out more workers into the harvest. But here's the question: how can they preach unless they are sent? I'll never forget my first international missions experience. I've never been one to kind of tiptoe into the water. I usually dive in. And my first mission experience out of country was to go to Niger, West Africa. Niger had 1,200 believers in a country of 12 million people. Almost no gospel presence there at all. Most of the believers were French, who remained in Niamey in the capital. Almost no indigenous believers. We were working with a missionary couple called named Brad and Sally Womble, who were from Hopkinsville. We got connected, and we decided to go over there with them. I'll never forget the first morning I woke up in Niger. I was awakened by the Muslim call to prayer, which had a bullhorn right outside of my bedroom. I have to admit, the first 2 days, that made me incredibly mad, you know, because it woke me up. But after a couple of days, the feelings moved from mad to sad because I realized how many people were lost thinking that they could pray their way to favor, thinking they could do good works to favor, think that they could do enough to make God happy. And I remember on about the fourth day, I begged God. I said, God, would you let me stay? Would you let me stay? And internally, clearly, I heard God say, I've called you to go back and get people to go. That was God's calling on my life. And so since then, I've pushed the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Since then, I've encouraged people to get involved in missions. Since then, we've continued to try to up our cooperative program giving. Did you notice the word here wasn't go? I mean, honestly, think about that. Wouldn't it make more sense if it was go? How are they going to call if they don't believe? And how are they going to believe unless they hear? And how are they going to hear unless somebody preaches? And how is somebody going to preach unless they go? But it doesn't say that. It says, how can they preach unless they are sent? You see, getting the message to the nations is a whole church process. And those who help send should be every bit as committed as those who go. William Carey famously compared missions to going into a deep, dark mine. And he says, I will go down into the darkness if you will hold the rope. There are people who've gone into the darkness of our world who are expecting us to hold the rope. One of the ways that we do that is through giving to missions. Last year, Porter Memorial gave over one half of a million dollars to mission endeavors. We're holding the rope for those 79 missionaries and the 3,500 like them. We're holding the rope for church planters who are in gospel-bearing places. We're holding the rope so those in darkness can hear. And I pray that you would consider giving radically to get the gospel out. I pray that you wouldn't just spend more for you, but you would think about getting Jesus to more. The urgency of the mission requires something of all of us. But we don't just go because people need it. We go because God loves the willing. Romans 10:15 says, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. God loves people who take the gospel to the nations. This quote is from Isaiah 52. And this word for gospel, especially in the Greek, was used for an announcement of victory. You know, there's big risk when you send all of your men out to fight in a battle. There's big risk when they go out and they fight a competing army. They might win and they might lose. And if they lose, your village, your nation, your existence is in danger. And so in those days that lacked communication, when the battle was over, a herald would go before and he would go back to the nation or he would go back to the city and they would see that person coming over the hill and they would know how that they needed to prepare for what was coming next. And if they saw them proclaiming good news, it was a beautiful sight to them. When it says, when it talks about our gospel, it talks about that one who brings this good news, that herald who brings this good news, going into those dark places, telling people about the gospel of Christ. Now, this quote is talking about Israel's being taken into captivity, and Isaiah foreshadows Israel coming back to Babylon, or from Babylon to Jerusalem. But I want you to hear this passage, because it's far more than that. It is a prediction that they're going to come back, but it looked not only to the day right in front of Isaiah, it looked to a day far beyond that. Does anybody remember what happens in Isaiah 53? You get the clearest prediction of Jesus in the entire Old Testament. You get a picture of one who would be crushed for our iniquities, one who would be pierced because of our transgressions. You get this clear picture that our sin, our iniquity would be laid on him. It's the clearest picture. That's why the Dead Sea Scrolls are such a big deal, that we find the passage of Isaiah 53 before Jesus comes onto the scene predicting what would happen to Jesus. Here's Isaiah 52. Listen to it. For this is what the Lord says, you were sold for nothing, and you'll be redeemed without silver. Verse 4, for this is what the Lord God says, at first my people went down to Egypt to reside there. Then Assyria oppressed them without cause. His people had been oppressed over and over again, and most of the time it was because of their own sin. He goes on to say in verse 5, so now what have I here? This is the Lord's declaration, that my people are taken away for nothing. It's rulers' well. And this is the Lord's declaration, and my name is continually blasphemed all day long. This is, you're taken away because of what you've done, and it's a disgrace not only to you, but it's also a disgrace to me. He continues on in verse 6. He says, therefore my people will know my name. Therefore, they will know on that day that I am he who says, here am I. I am the great I am. They will see me in that day. I'm going to return them. He says in verse 7, how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of the herald who proclaims peace, who brings news of good things, who proclaims salvation, who says to Zion, Israel, your God reigns. He says in verse 8, the voices of your watchmen, they lift up their voices, shouting for joy together. For every eye will see when the Lord returns to Zion. The picture of the temple's presence being taken away. Ezekiel prophesied that it would come back and rest once again on the mountain of God. There was going to be praise when they returned from Babylon, but it was far more than that. Far more than that. Keep reading in this passage. He says, the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. Verse 10. He tells us that the Lord has displayed his holy arm in the sight of all the nations. God is doing what he's doing in Jerusalem. God is doing what he's doing in Israel so that the ends of the earth will see the salvation of God. And then listen to how it shifts. We start the suffering servant section here at the end of chapter 52. He says in verse 13, see, my servant will be successful. He will be raised and lifted up, and he'll be greatly exalted. He'll be raised on a cross. He'll be put in a tomb. He will be lifted up from the grave, and he'll be given a name which is above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess. Verse 14, it says, and just as many people were appalled at you, his appearance was so beaten by the cat of nine tails when he was lashed by the Roman soldiers that he was disfigured, that he didn't even look like a man. He didn't even look like a human being. But then it says in verse 15, but through this act, you see it? He's going to sprinkle many nations. Through this act, through his shedding of blood, through his taking on our the wrath of God on our behalf, kings will shut their mouth because of him, for they will see what had not been told them, and they will understand what they had not heard. But how will they hear? Unless we go. It's interesting to me that he calls this act of going beautiful feet, because feet are ugly, right? If I had told you at the beginning of the service, at the end of my sermon, we were going to do a foot washing, I would have thinned the crowd by 50%. And it's not because you're afraid of getting your feet wet. You just don't want to either touch somebody else's feet or you don't want yours to be seen. If I said we were doing that next year, pedicure sales in South Lexington would go way up. I get that. But when God looks at feet who are turned in the direction of gospel sharing and who take the gospel forward, God says, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. Verse 16. But when they go, not all obey the gospel. That's the reality. Not all will obey the gospel. But success for us is in the going, not in the response. Right? Telling the story is our job. Transforming hearts is the gospel's. And then he asks a question at the end of verse 16. He says, who's believed our message? A response is important. Eternity is in the balance of the response. Heaven and hell will be determined by how a person responds to Christ. And I pray that you have. For faith comes from what is heard. Today, the message of the gospel has been proclaimed in this room. It is intersecting with your heart. Faith will either be utilized in the message received, or you will reject the message. No one here can say they have not heard. Oh, you might not have listened, but the message was heard. I pray today that you would respond to Christ. Five takeaways. Number one, I hope you got from this message that every nation needs to hear the gospel. I know that many Christians don't believe there's only one way of salvation. They don't believe the world's greatest problem is lostness. I hope you understand people who do not know Christ are lost, regardless of what they've heard. That is the message of Romans. You can deny Romans, but that is the message. Number two, I hope that today you also will feel led to support those who, let me give you this again, support those who feel called to go. Maybe God has called you to go. Maybe not. I pray that you will use your life in support of those who do. J.D. Greer uses this phrase a lot, and I thought it was appropriate for today. Put your yes on the table. Here I am, Lord. Send me. Here I am, Lord. Wherever, whatever. I would also encourage you to live as a sent person wherever you are. You may not know everywhere God is going to send you, but you can be sure that you are sent to the people in your life right now. That's why he put you where he did. God has you in your place for a reason. There are no accidents in the kingdom of God. The people in your life need to hear as well. Don't fail your purpose. Live as sent. I mentioned that I went to the Southern Baptist Convention this week. For the last few years, I've taken Nuno with me. Many people think I take Nuno with me because I like hanging out with him. I really take him with me because I don't know how to get an Uber. And so, true story. Yeah. And so we get down there to Louisiana, and Nuno gets the Uber. That's a long story. We won't even talk about that. But we get our ride. We go to the hotel. On Monday, one of his children has an accident. And he needs to come home. So he flies home on Monday, and of course, you know, I blessed him. Hey, go home, man. Do what you need to do. Please go. But then I realized on, like, Wednesday, I was going to have to get my own Uber. Well, I'd never done that before, and I'm an old man and technology and an old man, you know. So anyhow, I downloaded the app. I got my Uber, and I was pretty happy because I got the economy because I'm a cheapskate, and I got the economy car, and I didn't know what I was going to get, and I pull, the guy tells me to look for a blue Tesla, which I thought was okay, you know, so I get in, and I'm riding to the airport, which is about a 30-minute drive from where we were staying, and while I'm riding, I begin this conversation with a man who had been driving for about 9 years in the United States as a driver, several years for Uber. He had just recently moved to New Orleans. He was one of five children. His four brothers lived in Jordan. I had a pretty good idea he was Islamic, and so I wanted to find out his story. We began to talk, and of course, I wanted to share the gospel with him, and while we're riding, I talked to him about Jesus' death and resurrection. And of course, Muslims believe in Jesus. I hope you understand that. But they believe that Jesus is one of their prophets. And they don't believe one of their prophets could be crucified. And they just don't understand that part. And I know that. And so I'm making sure that I talked to him about Jesus' death and his resurrection. And I told him, he said, well, and I said, yes, you know, all faiths have interesting points and you should explore. But I said, would you do me a favor and read more about the resurrection? would you read more about the resurrection? And he promised me that he would. We had good conversation. It went well. He didn't convert. I'm not, you know, I wish I had that story. But I get out of the car after sharing the gospel because I believe all people need to hear the gospel. And I'm walking in, and he's pulled at a 45-degree angle away from the drop-off zone, and all of a sudden, I hear somebody lay on the horn. And I turn around, and it's my driver. I'm like, what is he doing? And so I walk over there, and I'm thinking, oh, he's going to accept Christ. He didn't accept Christ. He gave me my cell phone back, which I had left in the car, that had my ticket, my email, all of my information. Have you ever come out of a really, you know, could have been bad situation and you came out okay and you got like the shakes because you realized how bad that could have gone down? Whew, that's where I was at. And as I was thinking and reflecting on this story, I thought to myself, I'm really glad I have a Heavenly Father who loves me. Because that was nothing but grace. I was in the back seat. And he had happened to look in the back seat to make sure it was clear, and he got my phone. It reminded me of how much privilege I have having a Heavenly Father. You see, every week I get to be reminded of the gospel, and even when my sins still feel heavy at times, I'm reminded that his blood washes away my sin. And I'm reminded of hope, that even though that I don't deserve a future and I don't deserve the glory of heaven, I've got it because of Christ. I thought about how privileged I am. But privilege doesn't mean that you're in right standing with God. Israel was the most privileged of nations, and they rejected God. And there are people here today who will reject God. You know what's worse than never hearing the gospel? Hearing it every week and not receiving it. So I'll leave you with this. Take advantage of your privilege and say yes to Christ. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I pray, Father, that you would take what has been preached and you would translate it to hearts through the power of the Holy Spirit working within the individual. And I pray that every individual here who has heard this message, Lord, would recognize today that they are engaging the gospel. They're either rejecting or accepting. And I pray, Father God, that you would find tender hearts today. Those of us who've been believers for years, Lord, help us to continue to give thanks and say yes and amen to the gospel. And if there's somebody here who's never received what you've done for them in a personal way, I pray even today they would. Lord, thank you for what you've done for us. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're going to stand. We're going to sing one last song. After we sing, there will be pastors down here at the front who would be glad to talk to you about faith in Christ, being a member of our church, being baptized, or just praying with you. If you'd like to come, you can after we sing. Hey guys, thank you for being here today. Fathers, I pray that you will lead your households in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. I hope you will give them a godly example. I thank you for being with us today and worshiping with us today. A couple quick announcements. Number one, I want to mention that Discover Porter is coming to our church next week at 9:45. If you'd like to know more information about our church, you can come at 9:45. You can get on the webpage, go to events, and register or call the church office. Also, children's baptism class is next week. We would encourage you to, if you have a child who's asking questions, to get them in the children's baptism class. Wednesday night, and if everybody can hear this just real quick, Wednesday night, I'm going to be teaching in here on Wednesday night. Really, I'm not teaching. I'm going to be giving information on my perspective of what happened at the Southern Baptist Convention and kind of some of the key events and elements. If you would like to be a part of that, we made a lot of news this week. Some of it seemed to be really positive. Some of it maybe not so much. We never expect the press to tell our story, for us. That's our job. But I'll be glad to go over that with you this week. Thank you for being here. May the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you, be warm and be filled and be gone.